Good afternoon, and welcome to the Water Research Foundation webcast on the project Energy Recovery from Pressure-Reducing Valve Stations Using Hydrokinetic Turbines. My name is Linda Rieke, and I'm a research manager at the Water Research Foundation, and I'll be moderating today's webcast. This project was co-funded with one of our subscribing utilities, Halifax Water. It presents an interesting case study of the planning and implementation of a reverse action pump at one of Halifax Water's pressure reducing valve stations. The reverse action pump is currently operating and producing energy. I'm especially excited about this topic because I believe as energy becomes increasingly costly and valuable, this technology will continue to be of interest for water and wastewater utilities to generate energy and to offset energy costs. The technology is not widely employed yet, and this project presents a success story, including some of the opportunities, barriers, costs, and benefits of using an inline hydrokinetic turbine at a water utility. Before I introduce the presenter for this webcast, I want to go over a few housekeeping items. If you want to, you are able to download the slides from the webcast screen in the lower left-hand corner under Event Resources tab beneath the Ask Questions area. The webcast will last about an hour. The last 10 minutes will be dedicated to a Q&A. You can type a question for the Q&A at any time during the presentation, and we will answer the question after the presentation at the end. At the end of the webcast, after the Q&A, we will be pushing out a very short survey. Please take the time to complete the survey because we use your input as we plan future webcasts. If you have colleagues that wanted to attend this webcast but weren't available at this time, please know that the webcast is being recorded and will be available on demand within 24 hours after this event by going to the project webpage. So today's presenter, Jeff Knapp, was the principal investigator for this project. Jeff is the manager of energy efficiency with Halifax Water in Halifax, Nova Scotia, Canada, and has overall responsibility for the utility's energy management program, including energy efficiency and renewable energy generation. With over 35 years of industrial manufacturing, management, and engineering experience, Jeff is keenly aware of the social, technical, and economic challenges faced by water and wastewater utilities when trying to implement energy management and renewable energy programs. Jeff holds a Bachelor of Science in Mechanical Engineering from the University of New Brunswick, a certificate in Operations Management from the Richard Ivey School of Business at the University of Western Ontario, and a diploma in mechanical engineering technology from the New Brunswick Community College. He's a registered professional engineer in the province of Nova Scotia, a past president of Engineers Nova Scotia, and a certified energy manager. Jeff and his family live in the beautiful Annapolis Valley, Nova Scotia, Canada. And with that, Jeff, I'll turn it over for you to present on your story.
Thank you very much, Linda, and thank you everybody today for participating. Before I get started, I would just like to acknowledge another person, one of the co-investigators actually, Graham McDonald. Graham retired recently from Halifax Water, but he and his team were a very important part of this project. I'd also like to initially thank the Project Advisory Committee for this project, Richard Goodney, Dan Smith, and Vincent Hart. And there'll be a few other acknowledgments as well at the end of the presentation. So I guess to get into it, I'll give a quick outline of what I'm going to talk about today. First, I'm just going to give you a little introduction to Halifax Water. I'm going to talk about potential applications for this type of technology within a potable water distribution system. I'm going to talk about available turbine technologies that are suitable for this type of application. And then I'm going to really get into the details about what we call our Orchard Pressure Reducing Valve Chamber project. And within that, I'll talk about turbine selection, project economics. I'll provide some technical highlights around the installation. I'll talk a little bit about our SCADA system integration and how that operates. I'll talk about system testing. I'll talk about impact on water quality, and finally, the energy production from the system and what we've seen over the past year. And then basically a few conclusions and recommendations and some acknowledgements. So let's get started. About Halifax Water, Halifax Water is Canada's first fully integrated water, wastewater, and stormwater utility. We're located in Halifax, Nova Scotia in Canada. That's on the east coast of Canada. And we're comprised of roughly a little over 470 employees, and we have a little over 80,000 customer connections, so it gives you a sense for the size of the utility. On the water treatment side, we have three large and six smaller facilities. They range in size from 60 million gallons per day to as little as 2,000 gallons per day, and those are U.S. gallons per day. We have 18 storage reservoirs comprising roughly a total of 71 million gallons of storage capacity. Our distribution system is comprised of about 180 pumping, meter, and pressure-reducing valve stations. And we also provide full fire flows for the municipality of Halifax. And we have, with that, over 7,700 fire hydrants in our system. On the wastewater treatment side, we have five large wastewater treatment facilities ranging in size from 91 million gallons per day to about 22 million gallons per day, and then 11 smaller, what we call community facilities located in various areas, remote areas of the regional municipality here in Halifax. And then in the collection system, we're comprised of about 180 different pumping stations. So a fairly large utility, not the largest utility in North America, but a pretty good size utility nonetheless. So briefly, potential water supply applications for this type of technology. You can see in the little diagram on the screen that anywhere that you really are discharging water into a reservoir within the supply network and discharging out to the environment is a potential application site for this type of technology. In the case of the Orchard project, you can see the small turbine that's shown at the bottom of this diagram where it's discharging into mainly a distribution system. That's more or less the type of system that we have here. It's discharging into a pressurized system. The only difference being is at the end of our pressurized system is we have two reservoirs that the system floats on during operation, so that's really the only difference. But you can apply this technology anywhere that there's significant and sustained flow and with a significant and sustained pressure differential and where the system is operating consistently for a good amount of time. You know, you wouldn't try to operate or install a system like this in a system that has very low and short diurnal flows, for instance. You wouldn't be able to get the energy production out of it. But any place that you have good, significant, sustained flows and pressure differentials is a good possible application site. For the Halifax system, we undertook a study in 2010 to try and determine which of our pressure-reducing valve chambers might be suitable for this type of technology. We came back with a number of them that looked reasonably good, but I would say the top three systems are shown here on this diagram. That being the chain control chamber, PRV station, the Roby 1 control chamber, and finally the Orchard control chamber. You can see the Orchard control chamber located sort of in the center of the screen at near the what's called the Bedford Basin of Halifax. That chamber, it doesn't have the largest pressure differential from the clear well at the water supply plant, but it does have very good sustained levels of flow, which we'll discuss a little later on. All of the flow to these chambers comes from Pockwock Lake, which is located near Halifax. And that lake is at an elevation of about 110 meters. It pumps up from that lake to the J.D. Klein water supply plant and then out to the clear well, which has an elevation of about 170 meters. And then from there, it's gravity fed all the way into the city and into each of these chambers and into the rest of our distribution system. So very simply, why do energy recovery from PRV chambers? Why do energy recovery at all with pressure reduction systems? Well, simply put, pressure reduction really equals wasted energy. whether you're pumping water to increase the pressure to distribute it and then reducing the pressure to distribute that to your customers, that is wasted energy. You've put more energy into it than you've really needed to at that point. The other way to look at it is if you have a gravity-fed system and there's excess pressure and you need to reduce that pressure before it gets to the customers, then, again, you have wasted energy there in the system that can be utilized and harnessed if there's enough of it. Wasted energy is really proportional to the head loss in the system, the flow, and the runtime of the system. So it's really a very green energy. It's energy that would otherwise be lost in the system. For those of you who may not be familiar with water distribution systems, this is the traditional way of doing pressure reduction. These two pressure reduction valves, or PRV valves, PRVs, are located inside of our orchard chamber. These are what would have traditionally provided all of the flow into the Sackville and Bedford regions of the Halifax Regional Municipality. These are two 16-inch pressure-reducing valves. They're Ross pressure-reducing valves, and these are very sort of traditional in water distribution systems here in North America. So turbine technology, there's really two types of turbines available. I'll talk about both of them briefly just to provide a bit of education to everybody. Impulse turbines and reaction turbines are the two main types of turbines available. Some are suitable for this type of application, some are not. Some of these turbines are thousands of years old. For instance, water wheels are a type of impulse turbine and are thousands of years old. A cross-flow turbine is a variation on a water wheel. It's a different type, but it's another type of turbine. There's also Pelton turbines and Turgo turbines. We did do a little bit of investigation at the start of this project into the Pelton and Turgo turbines to see if they were being used inside of pressurized systems. And in fact, they are, but the application of that type of technology is not very widely known. And so we were a bit reluctant to try and use anything, brand new like that or anything that was questionable inside of our system. They were really meant as well originally to be discharging into atmospheric systems, whether it's a tank or a river or a reservoir. So not really not highly developed for discharging into pressurized systems. The other types of turbines are reaction turbines. Many of our hydro installations around the world, the very large hydro installations, use this type of turbine. For instance, Kaplan turbines and bulb turbines, these are traditionally the very large turbines you see in hydro installations. You also see some Francis turbines in very large hydro installations, and you can also find them in very small applications. And in fact, we did consider Francis turbines for this application, but Francis turbines are better suited to variable flow conditions. And in our case, we had fairly consistent flow, and so we chose to go with a different type of turbine. But the Francis turbine certainly would have worked, but it's a more complex type of turbine because it has, some of them have variable vanes on the impellers, and they certainly have adjustable wicket gates as well to be able to deal with those variable flow conditions. But in the end, we chose not to go with the Francis turbine. And of course, there's Archimedes screw is another type of reaction turbine. So the type of turbine we decided to go with was something called a reverse acting pump or a pump as turbine. This is really a conventional centrifugal pump, a pump like you'd find in any water system, wastewater system, industrial applications, petrochemical refining. They're widely known, very proven technology, and the only difference is we're operating them a little bit different than a conventional pump. These pumps as turbines or reverse acting pumps have fixed geometry impellers. As a result, they don't like a lot of flow variability, but where you do have stable flow levels, they're very good technology in those situations. They're typically used in smaller applications. They're very simple construction, readily available technology, very comparatively low capital costs and very low maintenance costs, very reliable. And they're suitable for both open and closed discharge applications, which is really what was really important in our case. So this is the type of technology that we've chosen to go with in our application. This slide just shows you, gives you an idea of the application of various types of turbines. The orange lines that you see on the left-hand side of the chart show the typical application range for a reverse-acting pump. And the star approximately locates the operating point for the orchard project that we've installed. So we had a good fit with the technology where, you know, in the operating levels for these types of turbines. So it was a good fit with the technology. These types of turbines are very simple. There's one main difference between this and a normal pump. The discharge of a normal pump, it would now becomes the inlet on a pump as turbine. And vice versa for the inlet of the pump, it now becomes the discharge. So water is flowing through the turbine in what would normally be considered the reverse direction. As it flows through the turbine, it drives the impeller, which in turn drives the shaft of the generator and produces electricity. So a very simple operation. These pumps as turbine or reverse acting pumps are available from a number of very well-known and reputable suppliers, four of which I have shown here on the screen, KSB, Sulzer, and Flowserve. We ended up going with a Cornell pump, chiefly because our system integrator and designer, Rentricity, Inc., was affiliated with Cornell, and those were the ones they were using at the time. And, you know, there may be other manufacturers of these out there, but these are the main companies that supply and actively market reverse-acting pumps for use in energy recovery applications. So for the orchard application, as I mentioned earlier, the water is pumped up from Pockwock Lake, a distance of about 60 meters, or a height, an elevation of about 60 meters, to our J.D. Klein water supply plant. It then continues down from the clear well at the water supply plant to orchard to another elevation of about 72 meters, I believe it is. And so a total elevation difference of about 95 meters. And this gives us a very good opportunity for energy recovery. And certainly of that 95 meters, there's a natural elevation there between the lake and the orchard of at least 34 meters. So again, good opportunity for energy recovery. This slide shows you the historical operating characteristics of the pressure-reducing valve chamber. This is before turbine installation. And the red and black line that you see on the chart indicates the head differential between the inlet and discharge of the pressure-reducing valves. And so from this, we determined initially that we knew we had a head differential of about 40 meters at that location. The green line, the green line indicates the flow of the system. And based on that line, you're seeing an average flow of about 400 cubic meters per hour. But we ended up sizing the system slightly lower than that so that we took into account any significant variations in the flow. And you can see a few spikes that drop down to the 370 or 380 cubic meter per hour range. So that's where we sized the turbine at. You can also see a couple of locations where the flow shut down to zero. And these are during periods when they would shut off flow to the reservoirs when water wasn't needed, and that would shut the PRVs down. These are, I guess if we operated the turbine the same way, we would say that the availability of that system was about an 80% availability with 20% shutdown time. So these are the numbers that we use to try and determine how much energy was available, how much power, what the size of the system would be when we were initially looking at the project. From there, we went to trying to select a suitable turbine. This information is from Cornell, and we basically selected a 1200 RPM turbine. If you enter that chart at the bottom, which is the flow at around 3.6 cubic feet per second, and you come across with about 130 feet of head, you end up looking at the type of turbine that's shown there, which is a 5TR2 model Cornell turbine. And from that, you can select that turbine and look at how that's going to perform in your system. This chart shows basically how the turbine is going to operate in service. So again, if you enter the bottom of this chart at 3.6 cubic feet per second of flow, and you draw a line straight up, It gives you an approximate kilowatt output. It gives you an approximate efficiency. And then if you come across, you see that that turbine is going to dissipate roughly 130 feet of head, which is more or less in line with what we had originally expected from the system and what was available at that PRV station. So in terms of kilowatt output, it predicted we'd have about 32 kilowatts of power available, and we'd be running at about an 80% efficiency level. When the other interesting thing to note is when you come across the line that comes over to the head level on the left-hand side, you cross what's called the runaway curve. And this curve is basically an indication of how the turbine is going to operate when it loses load or when you lose connectivity to the grid. And one of the characteristics of any turbine like this is if you do lose load, it will what they call freewheel or run away. And they certainly do speed up a little bit. It goes from an operating speed under normal conditions of about 1,200 RPM up to a runaway speed of about 1,900 RPM. When we were first looking at this project, we thought, well, that's going to increase the flow rates and the downstream pressures. But in fact, that's not the case. It's somewhat counterintuitive. The flow actually drops off, so it drops from about 3.6 cubic feet per second down to about 1.5 cubic feet per second, which is a good thing. Basically, you're dissipating that, continuing to dissipate pressure and flow. But one thing it does cause is some upstream issues with pressure transients, so that was another area of concern for us that we needed to check and do some testing on with this project, and I'll talk more about that in a second. In terms of the initial project economics, we went in expecting to be able to sell our energy back to the grid under what we call here in Nova Scotia a community feed-in tariff energy rate, and we're selling this energy back to the grid at 14 cents per kilowatt hour with a predicted capacity of 32 kilowatts. It would produce roughly 230,000 kilowatt hours per year, and that's assuming about an 82% availability. Annual revenue from the system was predicted at about $33,000 per year. Total project cost of $489,000. That included, the WRF requirements for the report and presentations at a conference and as well as doing this webcast. It also included a one-time charge to have all of the system NSF ANSI 61 certified, which is a little bit of a significant cost as well. I think going forward, if we did another one of these, those costs would come down significantly. The project was part funded by the WRF plus the Nova Scotia Department of Environment. They've contributed $200,000. Overall, the project has a net present value of about $335,000 over a 20-year lifespan, an internal rate of return of about 5.8%, and a simple payback, all costs included, of about 15 years. If you only consider the Halifax water costs included in that simple payback, it's probably down around 10 years simple payback, which is good for this type of project. From a technical perspective and the types of components that were used in the system, we tried to use components that were simple, that were readily available, were well proven, and traditionally used as much as possible in our water system. And in fact, many of the components are identical components that are used elsewhere in our system, and that's why we chose them. The Cornell model, as I mentioned earlier, it's a 5 TR2 turbine. Very robust turbine. It's a very simple construction. It has an impeller, a simple mechanical seal. It's a John Crane Type 1 seal, and then it's direct coupled to the shaft of the generator, so there's no internal bearings on the turbine itself. The generator is a Marathon induction generator, again, readily available, very simple construction, common size. I think the turbine, the generator itself is a nominal 40 kilowatt generator. It's fully instrumented and monitored through our SCADA system. Fail-safe systems are in place. We have a reliable Beckwith protective relay that connects to the grid that protects both the generator from the grid and the grid from the generator should anything go wrong on either side. The surge relief valve is a clay valve type system. Probably one of the most important parts of the system is the variable rate inlet control valve. It's a Bray and a Rotorque, a Bray valve with a Rotorque actuator on it. This valve allows us to control the rate of startup and shutdown of the turbine, and allows us to minimize upstream and downstream pressure transients, and I'll talk more about that during the testing portion of the presentation. So overall, very robust, very well-proven technologies. I didn't mention it earlier, but one of the most important parts of this was being able to get the system completely NSF and ANSI 61 certified. NSF ANSI 61 is a certification that shows that there's no leaching of any chemicals or bad chemicals, bad materials into the water, the potable water system. So it was great to have that certification, and it's certainly a requirement here in Nova Scotia to have that. And I believe it's becoming much more common throughout North America. I think most water utilities in North America are required now to have NSF ANSI 61 certification on any components going into the system. So that was an important one for us as well. So the installation, this is a shot of the original chamber without the turbine installed, and you can see the two PRV valves there. And the turbine was installed over in the left-hand corner. You see there's a ladder there currently that was removed, and there was a water connection brought through that back wall, and then the turbine was connected to the discharge ports that are shown on the floor. Luckily, those ports were already in place, and we were able to use those for the discharge ports, which helped us on the cost side. This is a shot of the turbine after installation. You can see the water supply line coming in through that back wall through a red gate valve. It then feeds directly into the turbine, and off that inlet there's a bypass line that goes through a pressure relief valve you can see in front of the turbine that then discharges into the downstream side. And the turbine itself, it's kind of hidden behind the discharge line, but it shows that you can see the discharge point of the turbine near the floor with that larger red gate valve near the floor. And that's just a closer shot of the turbine and generator showing the inlet control valve and the Rotorque actuator. This is a shot of the system control panel. It's not a very big panel. It's, I believe, dimensionally, it's less than 3 foot square. The control panel is the one on the right. The panel on the left was an existing SCADA panel, and that was still in service, and we simply connected into that to feed some of the data from the turbine into our SCADA system. But that control panel on the right-hand side is the only real control requirement for the whole turbine. It houses everything, all of the protective relay equipment, the power meters, all of that sort of stuff is contained within that control panel. This is a shot of our PI from our PI data historian, which collects historical data from our SCADA system. And this is what we use to monitor the operation of the turbine. Here in this case, at this particular time when this screenshot was taken, you can see the turbine is colored red. That means it's on and producing power. And then there's various data points shown on the screen. You can click on any of those and then bring up a graph to show you historical data for any of those metering points. So it's a very robust, very good way of tracking performance of the system, doing troubleshooting when something might go wrong to see what's happened, and you know, basically see how the system is operating. This is the result of that screen, basically selecting data points for display on a chart. In this case, we're basically looking at over 80 production days, I believe, of the turbine. The red and blue lines at the top of the chart show the inlet and discharge pressure across the turbine. And we basically have about, I believe, 40 meters of discharge pressure or pressure differential across the turbine. And the orange line shows the flows of the system, and it's consistently showing flows of around 390 cubic meters per hour, which is slightly better than what we had originally anticipated. I think we had sized it for 370 cubic meters per hour. And then the green line at the bottom shows the power production. And we're seeing on average, at least in this chart, an average of about 30 to 32 kilowatts of power production. So again, it's right on track as we expected and predicted at the start of the project. The other interesting thing to note here is that we're no longer, or not very often anyway, shutting the turbine down for water supply reasons. They're now, there's enough increased water demand in that area that they're allowing the turbine to run consistently, you know, almost 100% of the time. And periodically they need extra water, so they will actually open the PRVs in parallel with this turbine. And you can see when they do that, there's a slight drop in power output of the turbine and also a significant increase in the flow from the system. So it's basically allowing the turbine to run continually and produce as much energy as possible, which should help us produce more energy and more payback in our system, generate more revenues, basically. Sorry. The other thing that we did that was very important was go through a fairly robust test regime or test procedures. We did a total of eight or nine test procedures, and I'll show you three of those test procedures here today, the ones that are highlighted in red: a normal startup, normal shutdown, emergency shutdown by disconnecting the system out at the pole. Basically, there's a disconnect switch there. We tested that by shutting that off. We tested it by hitting an emergency stop button, and we also tested it with an inlet valve failure condition. And basically, the emergency shutdown operates the same way for all three. So that's why I'm only showing you one of them here today. So as far as these charts are concerned, a little bit complicated, but I'll walk you through them. In this first one, which is a normal startup, it shows the control valve position starting to open just after 30 minutes and 5 seconds on the time scale. And as that valve opens, water starts flowing through the turbine, and you do start to see some pressure transients show up on the upstream and downstream side. But you also notice that the turbine doesn't really start to move until probably 30 seconds into the startup procedure. And that's because there's not enough flow yet going through that turbine to overcome the internal resistance in the turbine, the mechanical resistance in the mechanical seal and in the bearings and the inertia of the system. But after about 30 seconds, the turbine starts to rotate and then quickly runs up to its synchronous speed of 1,200 RPM. Again, at the same time, with the pressure transients occurring on the upstream and downstream side, for the upstream side, we actually see a negative pressure transient, as you would expect with the water starting to flow. We saw a negative transient there of about 9.5 psi. And on the downstream side, we see a positive transient of about almost 19 psi. One thing I should mention, I mentioned it earlier, being able to control the inlet control valve and the time lag between the amount of time it takes for that valve to open up, that really allows us to control those pressure transients on the upstream and downstream side. When we first started doing testing, we had significantly higher transients, and as we adjusted that inlet control valve, we were able to get them down as low as you see here, and probably could take them even lower if we wanted to extend the opening and closing time of that valve, but at the time we didn't think that was necessary. So that's a normal startup, what a normal startup looks like. On a normal shutdown, a little bit different. Again, you see the orange line is the control valve position, and it starts to close at the 9:15 point on the time scale. But you'll note that the turbine does not shut down until that inlet control valve gets to about the 30% open level. And once it does reach that level, that's when the turbine disconnects from the grid and goes into runaway up to about 2,000 RPM and then quickly dissipates in speed. And at the same time, you see the pressure transients that occur after that turbine shuts down. The reason we've delayed the shutdown of the turbine to the 30% level is we've simply allowed time to allow the flow to dissipate more slowly with the shutting of the valve, which has helped to reduce the amount of transient that we saw on the upstream and downstream side. As a result, you see a fairly low transient on the upstream side of about 12.5 PSI, and on the downstream side, you're seeing about minus 18 PSI on the downstream side with a slight rebound after the fact, but it's only about maybe 10 PSI. So again, a very controlled way of shutting down the turbine under normal conditions. The next slide shows basically an emergency shutdown situation with loss of grid connection. This is, again, a little bit busier. You can see the in this case, the control valve position line is a blue color, a turquoise color. And the speed of the turbine is the orange curve. You can see the turbine shuts down immediately upon emergency shutdown with loss of grid connection. What's initiated that turbine shutdown is basically the Beckwith protective relay has kicked out and then initiated an emergency shutdown of the control system, and that's what shut the turbine down. When that happens, that turbine immediately goes up into runaway speed. You see a significant drop in flow, and as a result, you see a relatively high upstream pressure transient. In this case, it went up as high as 15 PSI. You're also seeing a downstream pressure transient of about minus 25 PSI, and then it rebounds to about a 3.5 PSI positive transient on the downstream side. We thought that all of this stuff was reasonable inside of our system. Some of the other events that occur in our system have higher pressure transients than this, so this you know didn't worry us too much, but it was deemed acceptable basically. So that's basically what an emergency shutdown looks like for almost any of the emergency shutdown situations. And then finally, we had an actual downstream water main break event occur in February of last year, and we captured all of the data on the high-speed data loggers for the pressure transients as well as the flow and speed through the control system, and we're able to see the effect on the system and the turbine from that downstream water main break. Again, the control valve position line is shown in blue and the speed of the turbine is shown in orange. In this case, what's happened, the water main break event occurs at about 13:57:25 on the time scale, but the turbine doesn't shut down immediately because it continues to run until it went out on a discharge low pressure permissive of 50 PSI, and when it reached that point, that's when the turbine shut down. So the system recognized that it had a low pressure on the discharge and said, I don't like this, so I'm shutting down, and that's when the turbine shut down. Once that happened, it went into runaway speed and continued on at runaway speed until the control valve fully closed. In terms of transients, you saw the initial transient on the upstream side from the water main break because of the increase in flow through the system, but then you saw a positive transient on the upstream side because of the turbine shutdown. Again, it wasn't a very large transient and nothing to be too concerned about. On the discharge side, the pressure dropped off completely because of the water main break, basically. But one thing that we learned from this is that we realized that we didn't also in the control system have the instructions to have the pressure reducing valves come on as the turbine shut down in an event like this. Usually we would not want to allow flow to stop during a water main break event so that we keep the water, the distribution lines, the water main full of water so that we don't get into having to re-disinfect everything after the water main break event occurs in the upstream end of the water main. So since this happened, controls have been changed to prevent the turbine generator from shutting down in the event of a downstream water main break, and we would also turn on the PRVs, I think, in a case like this to make sure that there is flow continuing in the system. In terms of impact on water quality, we really didn't see any impact. We were measuring turbidity, residual chlorine, and pH. And this graph shows the levels of each of those both before and after the turbine installation. And we're seeing basically 26 to 27 weeks of data. And as you can see, the measurements for each of these, both before and after turbine installation, is well within what we would consider the normal levels. And certainly nothing ever approached the minimum or maximum levels for these metrics. So really no impact on water quality was seen whatsoever as a result of the turbine installation. Energy production and revenues, I guess the important curves to see here, the green curve is the cumulative energy production, and then the annual energy target at the top and the purple line. And as you can see, we slightly crossed that in 2015, so met our energy production targets, which basically means we met our revenue targets as well for the turbine. In 2016, I would expect that to be even better because of the way we've changed the operating parameters of the system, and we're now operating it continually, as I mentioned earlier. So again, very good results from an energy production and revenue perspective. From Halifax Water's perspective, there were a few things that we wanted to try and do from an R&D perspective to try and understand how these systems operate and how it would operate in our system. The major questions for us that were answered were, was there any impact on water quality? And we found none. You know, were we going to have to deal with any up or downstream pressure transients? I think, we did see small upstream pressure transients that initially concerned us, but we were able to adjust those out of the system down to reasonable levels. Similar for the downstream side, we saw some there, but nothing that was too concerning. I guess the reason pressure transients were so concerning for us is we're also considering installing this type of system on some of our older distribution zones. And we really wanted to make sure we understand how the turbine would operate and what those transients might be before we proceeded to install the turbine, a similar turbine on those older systems. So that was important for us. How would the flows be controlled? Would the downstream side see full flows, full pressure from the upstream side? And there was really no issues from that side of things. What would a loss of grid connection do to the system? And again, with the protective systems in place, there was really no impact. Same thing for turbine shutdowns, whether it's normal or emergency, there was no impact. What was the effect of a turbine runaway to be on the system? Again, we saw some upstream pressure transients due to flow reduction, but nothing that was not, out of the ordinary. And the other thing that we considered as well was putting surge relief on it, and we did in fact install a surge relief line around the turbine. That's a good device to put on any of these. It's a protective system that protects the upstream side from any real significant pressure transients that might occur. And so we would recommend that this, that sort of thing be installed in any of these turbines in a water supply system. We think it's necessary. And there was really no issues with respect to vibration of the system. So basically, in conclusion, I think we feel that installing an energy recovery turbine in an older, closed, pressure-controlled water distribution system is readily achievable, certainly. There are a number of these types of systems now installed and operating throughout North America, and there's some in Europe. We weren't able to find too many that were being installed or were installed inside of a tightly pressure-controlled distribution system like ours. A lot of them are installed in, open discharge reservoir tanks, those types of applications. It was, we weren't able to find too many that were installing them into a tightly pressure-controlled system. We feel confident now that these things can be installed very reliably inside of a water distribution system. You certainly need to have tight control over the turbine operating parameters and be able to reduce the pressure and flow transients. And as I mentioned earlier, you can do that by tightly controlling that inlet control valve on the turbine. So going forward, I think anybody that's interested in installing a turbine like this in you know, your own water distribution system, I think the requirements for success for a project like this is to be able to select an internal project champion. You know, water and wastewater systems or utilities are not always focused on renewable energy production. So having somebody inside that's focused on this type of activity is going to make this type of project go more successfully. Doing a very, exhaustive and accurate evaluation of the energy potential up front is important, and that data will also guide your financial model and being able to determine what the payback of a project like this is. Doing a thorough review of your local energy regulations, rates, and rebates, you know, whether you can connect to the grid at all, what sort of rate are you going to get from your local electrical utility? And are there any other rebates available? Local rebates for green energy projects is a good example. As many of these rebates as you can get on a project like this will help it pay itself back quicker. Making sure you understand what the design standards are, and again, I'll use the example of the NSF ANSI 61 certification. Also important is your local electrical codes and any of the other design standards that you may have in the utility. Should be applied to this type of project as well. Making sure you have an accurate financial model, again, from doing an accurate evaluation of the energy potential, that should provide you with a good understanding of your financial model. And as well, if you're using a very proven technology, your maintenance and operating costs should be fairly low, and that sort of data will feed into that financial model as well. When it comes to the design of the system, trying to make sure that you have a simple and space-efficient design is important, and it's something that's going to be easy for maintenance staff to work on, repair, replace components, that sort of thing, and that those components are readily available. Hiring a reputable installation contractor, and then doing thorough post-installation testing and condition monitoring, and also financial tracking is important as well. So that's really it. In closing, there's a few people that I would like to acknowledge. Certainly from the Water Research Foundation, Linda Rieke, the WRF Research Manager, and Valerie Roundy, WRF Project Coordinator. Both of these ladies and their support staff have been very helpful throughout this project. And also the Project Advisory Committee, Richard Goodney from the Mohawk Water, Valley Water Authority in Utica, New York. Dan Smith with Water One out of Lenexa, Kansas, and Vincent Hart with Corolla Engineers out of Denver, Colorado. Thank you very much for your support and guidance with this project. From Halifax Water, very important again, Tom Gorman, our manager of water infrastructure engineering, and Mark Feener, one of our project engineers who helped on the project. Graham McDonald, again, he and his staff, Graham has since retired, but he and his staff were very helpful in this project and very important with this project to make it happen. And his staff were comprised of Bill Stevens, Rob Sagan, and Justin Wilson. So thanks very much, everybody. And also on the Halifax Water side, all of the Halifax Water executive who were very supportive and really allowed this project to go ahead. Thanks very much. Also, our Nova Scotia Department of Energy and the Nova Scotia Department of Environment, important stakeholders in the project. And finally, Rentricity, our system integrator and designer for the system. And from Rentricity, I'd like to thank Frank Zamatero, Al Spinell, Kerry Hillebrand, and Marty Miko, who was with KLH Engineers. So with that, thank you very much, everybody, for taking the time this afternoon to listen to our presentation.
That's great. Thanks so much, Jeff. That was a really good presentation, a lot of detail on some of the things you went through to make this project a reality. So thanks so much. I do want to make our audience aware that the report is available on our website, and the link is provided in front of you. And again, there's some really good detailed information in the report. It makes for a good detailed case study. I do see we have quite a few questions, so why don't I launch into some of those, and we'll see if we can get through some of those. One of the questions that came up is, what is the life expectancy of the unit, and do you think it'll last the 15-year payback period?
Well, I think with a unit like this, you can probably expect, you know, with good maintenance practices, in excess of 40 years operation. I mean, there's pumps around that have been operating for 40, 50 years or more, and the same thing goes for small generators like this. It's basically, you know, another type of motor almost. It basically is. So with good maintenance practices on it, it should last for quite a long time. We fully expect it to last, you know, 30 or 40, in excess of 40 years.
And what are the criteria for this energy recovery system to work? For example, minimum head difference, flow, that type thing.
Well, I guess it would be difficult to give specific numbers for minimum heads and flows because it would really depend on the type of turbine that's selected and the size of the turbine. There's a wide range of turbine sizes available, and they go from fairly low flows and heads up to fairly high flows and heads. But I think what's important is that you do have, you know, a reasonable pressure differential or head. You do have good sustained flows, and you have good operating time so that the flows are consistently, you know, running throughout the day and night. If you have a situation where you have good flows and good head, but you're only looking at diurnal flows and it's only flowing for, you know, 6 or 7 or 8 hours a day, that's probably not a good application because you're not going to produce as much energy with the unit because it's only really running for 6, 7, or 8 hours a day. But if you have something that's, you know, that's consistently flowing all of the time, similar to what we've had here in this orchard project, and has, you know, reasonable head and flow levels, then it probably would make sense to do it because there's a wide range of pumps available. I think we've seen that Rentricity has since installed pumps that are probably down in the 10 kilowatt range, which is a very small pump. It's like a, you know, a 7.5 horsepower motor would be a similar size a pump. So they do make them fairly small.
Mm-hmm. What how long did it take to complete this project?
It took about, I guess the design of it took about 4 or 5 months, and then you were into procurement. So I think all told between, you know, from start to finish was probably about a year and a half.
Okay.
But you could do it much quicker than that. You know, that's the I guess, the timeline that it took us, but it can certainly be done much quicker than that. Mm-hmm. We proceeded fairly carefully because we wanted to make sure that that everything was being done correctly in the system.
The next question refers to the TP2 normal shutdown slide. So on that slide, the runaway rotation at 1999 RPM seems concerning. Are any special precautions needed to inhibit the vibration or noise or extra inspection for shaft bearing wear or lubrication?
Not really, because 2,000 RPM for a pump or generator of this size is not very high. I mean, these, keep in mind that motors of this size and generators of this size sometimes run at 3,600 RPM at a two-pole speed. So, you know, 1,900 RPM, while it seems quite a bit higher than its normal operating speed of 1,200, it's not very high for a pump or a generator like this. In terms of vibration, there is a little bit of vibration because of the, you know, there may be a little bit of cavitation going on at the discharge, but it's not great. It's not a large amount, so it's very manageable.
Mm-hmm. And did you run simulated transient calculations prior to equipment purchase and installation?
We did try to understand through, you know, through Rentricity what the pressure transients might be, and we did have some estimates, and I think they weren't too far off to what we experienced in the field. You know, if they'd been too far off, I don't think we would have even proceeded with it, but they seem to be quite reasonable. And knowing that we could control these things with the inlet control valve parameters and the amount of time it takes to open and close that valve made I guess the transients more palatable.
Did you consider using a variable frequency drive to allow variable flow and pressure delivery?
You really can't use a variable frequency drive in this type of an application because it's a generator and it has to run at the synchronous speed that it's running. It's supposed to run at to provide power to the grid. So you're not able to run it at variable speed conditions. Mm-hmm. And the other thing is that this type of turbine is not really meant for variable flow conditions. It's meant to operate at a certain flow and certain head. If you go much beyond, you know, above or below that, the efficiency of the unit drops off fairly quickly. If you had something where you had variable flow conditions and you wanted to capture those, you know, capture the energy from that variable flow all of the time, then you would need to go to something like a Francis turbine that has, you know, variable wicket gates on the inlet to the impeller, and on the more complicated systems, even variable vanes on the impeller themselves. And that would give you the variable flow capability if you were to use a Francis turbine.
Okay. What is your unit energy cost for purchased electricity and electricity exported to the grid?
Well, it depends on the rate. If you're looking at industrial rates, the energy rate to, you know, a utility like Halifax Water, just for the energy rate, is probably in the range of, 8 to 9 cents per kilowatt hour. If you factor the demand charge into that, then you're up into the 10, 11 cents a kilowatt hour rate here in Nova Scotia. Residential energy rates are probably close to or a little over 15 cents a kilowatt hour now here in Nova Scotia. And we're being paid under the community feed-in tariff program 14 cents a kilowatt hour. That program here in Nova Scotia was started to allow green energy projects to sell energy to the grid. They were selling it at a little higher cost, but we're trying to reduce the amount of coal-fired energy that's being put into our system, which I think at this point in time we're still providing 40 or 50, maybe 60% of our power from coal. So there's a big push on to try and increase the amount of green energy projects here in Nova Scotia because of that.
Mm-hmm. So you're getting a really lucrative price for the electricity you're selling to the grid.
Yeah, it's certainly better than what we purchase energy, you know, at an industrial rate. It would be slightly less than what a homeowner would pay for, you know, under the residential rates.
Right.
Yep.
Can the existing pressure-reducing valves be used for turbine bypass if they are automated?
Yes, and in fact, they are. We do use them periodically. In fact, we do, as I showed on some of the graphs there, we do run them in conjunction with the turbine when extra flow is needed. So we will keep the turbine running and then also open up the pressure-reducing valves to allow extra flow into the system.
Mm-hmm. How does the design service life of PRV and pumps as turbines compare? And will you wait for end of life to remove the PRVs and replace with turbines?
No, I don't think there, in this case with Orchard, there'd be no need to do that. As well, having the PRVs there as a backup is a good thing, as a safety precaution, you know, having some redundancy in the system. In terms of the life of a PRV, I think the lifespan of those is very long. You're probably looking at, again, into the with proper maintenance into the 30, 40, 50 years, depending on the system.
And here's a good one. What about lessons learned, for example, unforeseen issues and how they were dealt with?
Lessons learned, I think one of them was the chamber that we were installing it into. I think, you know, at some point we all wished we had more room and more space. You know, it would be nice to have a larger chamber, but that wasn't the case. But we managed to get around it anyway with a few unique design, you know, a few unique design methods. Another lessons learned, I would have to say the NSF 61 ANSI certification, ANSI 61 certification. We had not started out, you know, we had assumed that everything that we were purchasing that would be available with that certification, but at some point we realized that the turbine was not. So I guess don't take anything for granted. Make sure you've understood all of these things up front before you get into it. As a result, we had to scramble a little bit to make sure we had the unit NSF ANSI 61 certified.
Yeah. Well, I think I see we're at the top of the hour. We do still have, I don't know, about 10 questions. So what I think I'm going to do is we will look at those questions and post answers to the questions on the website after the presentation. So, Jeff, I do want to thank you again for providing a really great insights into this kind of technology. And for our viewers, I would ask you to please take the survey that's going to be pushed out to you right about now. Thanks, everybody, for joining today's webcast.
Thank you, everybody.